everybody ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show?
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the MindDog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. We're going to talk about gospel music today. And what I'm going to learn about is the curse of gospel music. Should be a really interesting program. You know, one thing old people like me tend to fall into, a trap we fall into, a lot of people like me, all my age, is that we tend to dismiss younger people as not being very wise and not able to teach us something. And that's a big mistake to make. You can learn from somebody, no matter how old you get. There's always somebody, you can learn something from everybody, and there's always something young people can teach you. And a lot of older people tend to close their minds towards those things. So I have a young man who's very bright and articulate today, and I look forward to learning from him about what is called the curse of gospel music. You know me, I love all kinds of music and don't like to think of any kind of music as cursed or bringing a curse, but look forward to learning something. Before I introduce you to my guest, who is a dynamic speaker, I need to first talk about our sponsors a little bit. Today's program is brought to you by Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital, as you know, is a business lender matching platform that helps you get the best credit lines you can get. You can apply online in 60 seconds or less, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. You heard me correctly. I did say start. If you don't have a business yet, but you got a solid business plan that can help you get funding, get a good marketing plan, business plan on paper, well-documented, they can help you get funding. Get the best funding you can qualify for. The strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, bridge loans, all that kind of stuff. Work with real estate, startups, as I mentioned, franchises, restaurants, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started with them, really simple. Just go to apply, apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Apply.fundwise.com/minddog. Do appreciate you patronizing our sponsors. Now, today, my guest is William Bowers, a.k.a. Brother Crumb. He is the founder and host of Crumb TV, which is a YouTube channel, which I would describe as part religion, part history, part politics, and part educational, and all of that combined. He's got a message to share with me today, and I'm eager to learn from him. So please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Brother Crumb to the MindDog TV podcast. Brother Crumb, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Shout out to MindDog TV. It is a pleasure. Thank you again.
It's my pleasure to have you here. Now, as I mentioned, I love all kinds of music, and it pains me to think of any kind of music as cursed. And I don't really know what we're going to talk about other than that title. So I'm a little nervous about it, because I love music. I love gospel music, and I don't want to think of it as being somehow negative. But before we go there, maybe you can let the audience know a little bit about Crumb TV and exactly what it is you do and why you do it.
Absolutely. Peace and love to the family. I am your humble brother, Crumb. I go by the moniker, the Master Student. Crumb TV is basically a platform for the ushering in of the Aquarian age, the age of information. We all have computers or cell phones at the very least, and the access to information is new. The information might not be new, but we just have a different access than what we once may have had in the past. When I was a kid, I had a library card, but you could only check out a certain amount of books, and you better bring them back in time. So now this is a new time. It's a fun time. We grew up in an age where, for my generation, it wasn't cool to learn. Learning was boring. Well, I'm the energy that's going to change that.
And it's located at crumbtv.info for people who want to check it out today after the broadcast. I highly recommend it. There's some really compelling and interesting content in there, and quite educational. So if we can, I want to give you the platform because, you know, you mentioned in our introduction, we met through a podcasting site that hooks guests up with hosts and all that kind of stuff. And you mentioned the curse of gospel music. I'm really interested in that. Please enlighten me.
Well, let me first say that I, like yourself, am a very passionate, avid lover of music. I love all music. I think there's a word for people who venture outside of their stereotypical cliche genre, and that's eclectic. I am an eclectic. You know, I have an appreciation for jazz, different genres, not just, you know, the ones in my culture, but nonetheless. So now if we look at the curse of gospel, the name is a little misleading. Let me apologize for that. It's actually not the curse of gospel. It's the curse of leaving gospel, which we saw gospel music not gospel music, old Negro spirituals. Gospel came later. When our ancestors were on the plantations, they sung. That wasn't gospel. Those were spirituals. So after spirituals had their foundation in the colonial times and the times of slavery here in America, music transitioned to rhythm and blues, or what we now know today as R&B. Simultaneously, as rhythm and blues is being born, which might be on par with jazz, which may have come later. We'll talk about that later. But this is during the time of gospel. Basically, what would happen is the biggest network that our people had was the church. Everything went down in the church. The church was everything. However, the church had a twin sister that was on the dark side. And we call that, because the church is a network. Politicians would go through the church. A lot of our talent came through the church, so on and so forth. But the church's twin sister on the dark side was the Chitlin Circuit, which was also a network. But these wouldn't be at the traditional church. It would be at what they call a hole in the wall, a speakeasy. Right. Different terminology depending on where you're from.
Right. So gospel music evolved out of Negro spirituals, and basically the Negro spirituals in a way were a corruption of the people's belief system in the first place, because we're talking about people who came to this country against their will and were forced into slavery. And basically, Christianity was not part of their culture when they came here. But a lot of those, what we labeled as Negro spirituals, were Christian in nature, right? So talk to me about the imbalance there, because it seems to me like they were quick to adopt what was being forced on them.
Well, if you look at a lot of these different denominations of Christianity, in some of them, especially in the Caribbean, you're not going to see, well, at the face value, you're going to see Christianity, but it's Christianity masking something else. So now you're going to have what they call Santa Maria. It's right. A form of Christianity where they had to adopt the oppressor's religion, but they kept aspects of their culture inside of it. So it looked from the outside or from far away like they were just doing Christian things, but they had aspects of their religion. So now you're going to see the same thing on a plantation. They just used that as a ploy. Actually, there's another one called capoeira, where they would do martial arts, but they would disguise it as dancing. So now they're going to do this singing, but the singing was about getting free. It was about freedom. It was, you know, things to liberate them, not necessarily giving praise to a god directly from a far away. Oh, they just sang it in the field, but those were freedom songs.
Gotcha.
You know,
and was that Apollo, was that punishable? I mean, obviously, the slave owners and the people who were keeping them in bondage, if they would have thought that, you know, this is kind of trying to motivate them to be free, that would kind of be something to be worried about, no?
Absolutely, absolutely. However, comma, it was never caught. No one ever caught on. But, you know, those songs, follow the drinking gourd. Follow the drinking gourd? What are you talking about? Oh, that's the way to get free. Because did you see that star? You'll go, you know. So, no, no one ever caught on. And I think that is a part of the genius that our culture had at the time. You know, there was no Twitter. There was no newspapers. We weren't allowed to read. What? There is no media. So how do you get the message across? It's genius.
Right. And a lot of that music is still the roots of the music, the origins of the music and the forms that were in those music are still in a big part of our pop music today. And we hear it incorporated. A lot of people may not realize that they're listening to elements that were first kind of introduced into the Western Hemisphere that way. But they're still pretty prevalent in modern music. Yes.
Absolutely. Now, when you look at old Negro spirituals, it's going to be the only genre of music that has a classification of people, Negro. There is no other group. There is no other music that has a classification of people designated to it. So there's going to be a big implement within that. So now Negro spirituals die out. Slavery's over. We're moving on. After Negro spirituals, we're going to see rhythm and blues, which we now know as R&B. A lot of these, I'm sorry, excuse me. After spirituals, you're going to get gospel. These people are just, you know, they're coming from the plantation. They were already in the church. They're off the plantation. They're still using the church as a cultural hub. So all the talent in the community, the best people in the community, grandma, you know, whoever can bake the best cakes, whatever the case may be, we all do that at the church. That's the central location. That's the hub. So now, From gospel, we go to R&B because we already had jazz during the evening times. We already had rhythm and blues. What was going on during the evening time? So now at these juke joints, they would have Jews would come in, sit quietly in the back, you know, just taking in all the energy. After everything was done, the Jewish guy most likely would approach the person who had the most talent. Because remember, the guy who is singing at the juke joint on Saturday night, he's the same guy singing in the church Sunday morning. We all know how that go.
Right. Yeah.
So now the Jew takes the black into their culture. I'm sorry. Into their business, because a lot of the industry is ran by Jewish media moguls, Jewish music moguls, Steve Stout. I'm sorry, not Steve Stout. Who am I thinking about? The tall Israeli. His name is Lior Cohen. He's one of the big Cohen, Jews, yeah, in the pop. Yeah, Lior Cohen. So now these gospel singers go into what we call secular music. It was small little moves. It wasn't a big thing until a gospel singer by the name of, you tell me if you heard this name before, this gospel singer by the name of, I'm going to tell you his name in just a second. He sung the song, I Was Born by the River.
It wasn't Sam Cooke.
Sam Cooke.
Yeah. Sam Cooke. Yeah, I wanted to ask you about Sam Cooke because I know he was, the people were not, in the church were not happy that he was starting to sing secular music and kind of drive that into, yeah, so tell me a little bit what you know about him.
That was controversial.
Well, yeah,
that was controversial. You were singing gospel and you switched over to secular. Grandma, right, not happy with that. The preachers, the deacons, the usher board, that was a big deal. It was very not good. The church took a blow when Sam Cooke went secular. So right now Sam Cooke experiences a curse that that a lot of gospel singers turn secular experience this curse. This, my elder, is what the curse is. Do you know what happened to Sam Cooke upon his death?
I don't. I mean, I know there's a lot of mystery around that, and some people think he was assassinated, specifically because he was starting to bring some of the freedom original from the freedom language from the original Negro Spirituals into AM pop radio, and a lot of the white people who were in power at the time saw that as a threat. And the civil rights movement was just starting to grow and thought this guy might be trouble. And so there's a lot of conjecture about that, but I don't know. So if you do, please educate me.
Well, okay, number one, I have to be respectful. I as well don't know. No one knows. However, if someone from the outside looking in were to look at all things considered, not just the tree, let's look at the whole forest, I think it would be easy to conclude exactly what you've concluded today. So Sam Cooke comes into the game. He owns his masters. He's not the average singer. He has control. He gets all the money. They get a little bit, and he's about to change the whole industry. So he dies. It's a very sketchy death. It's a very ugly death. Supposedly, this woman shot him 3 times, is what the coroner said.
Right.
But if you look at the body, he looked like a 7 foot, 400 pound football team just obliterated him. Like,
Right.
oh, wow, that gunshot gave him a black eye. What?
Yeah, it doesn't add up. I agree. A lot of it is really sketchy, and it seems like one of those things that we'll never know the whole truth. But not knowing the whole truth leaves us open to assume that the kind of scenario that I laid out was pretty right. Because if you look at the times and what was going on there, it certainly suggests that, yeah, this guy's making a lot of money, but he could, he might stir up some trouble. For the power that was at the time, and that was dangerous.
I mean, at this particular time, we're not even 100 years removed from slavery.
Right.
Negroes aren't moving like this, you know, that they're not the nation's heartthrob and so on and so forth. But for Brother Sam, unfortunately, his story just gets worse from here. So now he's a ladies' man, and he's been drawn to this place by this Jezebel, by this Delilah type character, and he falls by a woman supposedly. So now at his funeral, he had two funerals. Sam Cooke had two funerals. The first funeral, the coroner did such a botched job. His mother was livid. She was just, it was the worst day of her life. She, because he was beaten to a pulp, said, "You cannot do that to my son." So after the first funeral, she demanded the coroner do. I'm not the coroner. Excuse me. Who prepares the body for the funeral? Funeral parlor. The
yeah, mortician.
Mortician. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The mortician did such a poor job because he, you know, Sam was mangled. She did such a poor job. She demanded they fix him, and they had a second funeral. It gets worse from there. At Sam Cooke's second funeral, his protege, the one he put on. Matter of fact, it's not even that he just put this guy on. He put the guy's whole darn family on. I put you on. I put your brother on. I put your mama on. Put your dad. We put the whole family on. Isn't it the brother's name is Bobby Womack. Have you ever heard that gentleman's name before?
Oh, of course. I love Bobby Womack, and I love his music. Yes.
So good brother Bobby, who is claim to fame, is Sam Cooke. Had there been no Sam Cooke, we wouldn't know who Bobby Womack is.
Absolutely. That's true.
Bobby Womack is only the talent. He's not the brains. He's not the bronze. He's not anything else. So now Bobby, being close to Sam, not only wears Sam Cooke's suit to Sam Cooke's funeral, one of Sam Cooke's best suits, Bobby Womack took it upon Sam's death and wore it to his funeral. Bobby, what's wrong with you? Not only that, Bobby escorted Sam's widow to that second funeral. A lot of people caught that and said, Bobby, matter of fact, not even a lot of people, Bobby Womack, mama. She said, "I seen you bring Bobby's Sam Cooke's widow to his funeral, and you wore his suit. You wrong for that." Bobby Womack mama said you wrong for that, and I will not stand by, but I still love you. So nobody tripped on it, whatever. So then 3 months later, after the funeral, Bobby Womack married Sam Cooke's widow.
Oh, I did not know that.
It gets worse. It gets worse. Bobby Womack mama said, I disown you. That's wrong.
Right.
That woman was vulnerable. You took advantage of the situation. It gets worse. About 3 to 6, 9 months. Now, keep in mind, I want the family to understand this information that I am delivering to you is documented. What is the name of Bobby Womack's book?
I don't remember the name of his book, but I could try to look it up quickly while we...
Oh, no, I was asking Google.
Oh.
Sorry.
Oh, good for you.
Bobby Womack wrote a book. I think it's called Midnight Train to Georgia or something like that. Bobby Train. I just looked it up, but it didn't pop up. Midnight Mover. I said Midnight Train to Georgia. In Bobby Womack's autobiography, the book he wrote himself, this is his testament. Crumb, you be on the internet too much. No. You might not be doing a lot of reading. But I tell you what, I'm gonna bring it to the forefront. So now, Bobby Womack said that his mama told him she disowned him, and he still moved forward marrying that girl. I don't think it was a year into the marriage. Within a year in the marriage, he starts sleeping not only with Sam Cooke's widow, but with Sam Cooke's 15-year-old daughter.
Oh my God, that is worse. Holy moly.
So now Sam Cooke in there one night tearing this little girl up. And Sam Cooke's widow walks in the room, turns the light on. And this is by Bobby Womack's words. She screamed out, what the F are you doing? Went, grabbed the gun. Bobby Womack bailed, said she shot, bat, grazed him. Because you know, Bobby Womack got a big head. He got a lot on his mind. Grazed him. It's not hard to hit and miss Bobby Womack head. It's like the broadside of a barn. It's a lot there. But anyway, she grazed him. They were divorced within a week.
Wow.
So it gets worse.
I don't know.
How could Bobby Womack be such a a-hole? This guy's a creep. He's a jerk. He's you know. Well, you know, you get dirt. Rumor has it, you know, because this is pedophilia, all types of stuff. Sam Cooke, rest in peace, rest in power, was sleeping with Aretha Franklin when she was 12.
Wow. You know, if I may, and I'm not excusing this at all, believe me, I know people are going to write me angry letters like you're excusing pedophilia. At that time, as weird as it may sound, people got married at 12, 13 years old sometimes, and it wasn't uncommon. Believe me, I'm not excusing it. I'm just trying to get into the why it and how that could have happened. And the other part of that is the industry itself can corrupt human beings. We're all susceptible to temptation and stuff like that. And the music industry itself, full of all sorts of bad temptations everywhere you look. It could happen to any of us, I think. Especially in that time and age. That's all I want to say about that.
Yeah. And that's right and exact. Now, I want to remind the family, based on that being the culture, remember in ancient Greece, it was commonplace for a man to have sex with a boy. So when we're going around these cultures, yeah, I get it. It was a culture. I don't know what that means, but sure.
Yeah, you know.
The Greeks was, hey, he's 9. Let's get him.
Right.
And this was public. Everybody's like, hey, you know. But nonetheless, yeah, absolutely. But yeah, so Aretha Franklin. How do we know that Sam Cooke had sex with Aretha Franklin at age 12? Well, Aretha Franklin had that baby. Yes, she had her baby. Wow. At like the beginning, like I think she had a baby like at her 13th birthday, the week after her 13th birthday, or the week before her 13th birthday. But you can do the math, like, oh wow, she has a baby at, she's not even 13. She clearly was having sex at 12. So they were at this little motel, and they were together, and there was an eyewitness who wrote their own autobiography. My apologies, I can't remember who the eyewitness is, but they say they saw Aretha Franklin go into Sam Cooke's room, or Sam Cooke go into Aretha Franklin's room, didn't come out till the morning. So you say, well, that's crazy. That's horrible. It gets worse.
Okay. I'm with you.
So now, a lot of people say it was Sam Cooke, but nobody knows what happened behind, quote, closed doors, or who else Aretha Franklin was having sex with. Well, according to Ray Charles, it wasn't Sam Cooke that got Aretha Franklin pregnant. Do you know who it was?
Is Ray going to say it was his?
No.
Oh, okay. No, I don't. Bobby Womack.
Her daddy.
Oh, yeah. I think there was something. I heard something about that at one point. Yeah.
Ray Charles said, I'm not surprised the little girl got pregnant at 12 for the simple fact, because remember, do you remember how Aretha Franklin got on?
No.
She got on through the church. This is the church of gospel. She came on as a gospel singer initially. Right. Do you know what church she was singing in?
No.
Her daddy church.
Okay.
So now she's singing at her daddy church.
Is that the same church that Sam sang at in Chicago, or no, a different church?
No, that's the same one. Come on now. You on it. So now what happened? Ray Charles says the reason he thinks the baby of Aretha Franklin, because when Sam, I'm sorry, excuse me. Ray Charles said the reason why is because when Ray Charles went to Aretha Franklin daddy's church, Ray Charles said it wasn't a church. It was more like a religious sex orgy.
Wow.
Brother Ray's words, not mine.
Wow. You know what? I don't, you know, Ray Charles, I don't think he had any reason to make that up. He's pretty much a straight shooter and, you know, told it like it was. So I don't doubt him.
Let's go into the curse of gospel, because Ray Charles stole gospel music and made secular music, and they put that in his movie.
Right. Yeah. And Ray Charles was kind of the guy that kind of opened the door for it to become popularized. Yeah, he with Modern Sounds and Country Western Music or something like that was the name of the album that kind of was a breakthrough into bringing that music into the secular radio.
1,000,000% factoid, wow. Facsimile. Yeah.
And so where did that lead us to? And, you know, part of the shame of this, and I we can talk about the personalities and the flawedness of the human beings and the people involved who, you know, like all of us had shortcomings and gave into temptations they shouldn't have. Sam Cooke, no matter what you can say about his personality, the man was incredibly talented and his music was monumental. And I think a lot of the modern generation loses that. I mean, he's not remembered on the level he should be for his music. There are so many people that we do remember, and you can remember people like Elvis Presley, but, you know, talent-wise, Sam Cooke, you know, was the king of his time, I mean, in music, and he's not remembered by the younger generations barely at all. If I ever bring him up, people are like, they don't know him. Young people don't know him. I think that's a sin.
Yeah, you know, going into the curse of gospel, I am feeling my age. I'm 40 now, and the new music is garbage. The music when I was a child that I loved, that was garbage. Music is going like people's taste in music. Like, what is this? This weirdo stuff that you that the children are listening to. What's wrong with y'all? So, you know, I understand that they don't know. My translation of what you are saying is the children don't know what good music is. I get it. I didn't know what good music was.
Yeah, I'm not one of those old people who frown on young people's music. I just think they miss out on that particular artist in a big way, because he was monumental. He was, you know, a lot of people talk about the day the music died, Buddy Holly and Big Bopper and Richie Valens. Sam Cooke was on that tour. Sam Cooke was the headliner above all those guys on that tour. But people remember people like Buddy Holly a lot more than they would Sam Cooke. And I think that, you know, his music was so good that I'll tell you this, when I play it with the guys in my band, they look at me like, what's that? I never heard that before. Bring It On Home to Me. And a lot of his songs that got just lost in the modern catalog of music. And I think that's a shame.
Yeah. Now I think there is a place for Sam Cooke in the Hall of Fame. There's music that is timeless. Sam Cooke has produced music that in 100 years from now, if by chance somebody hears it, like, wow, that, you know, move the heart chakra. So, you know, I can't help but to vehemently agree with you on that. It should be, if anybody takes any class on, you know, major points within music or whatever they would call that study, musicology or whatever, Sam Cooke would have to be somewhere within the curriculum. I would have to say that, honestly.
Yeah, absolutely. So now this curse of gospel music, where is the state of gospel music today? Because what they call it is contemporary Christian music. Is that the same thing or not?
Well, I think, unfortunately, gospel music has taken so many turns. Maybe the greater days of gospel are behind us. We know the millennials don't even go to church anymore. The big band sound survived through the church. You know, a lot of us never been to anywhere where there was live music other than the church. Yeah. Now I think the greater days are behind us. I'm not sure if the genre will last 500 years. But I think their better days are behind them.
Yeah. Well, that would be a shame, because there was such great music that came out of that. Even, you know, after the Ray Charles period, and we mentioned Aretha Franklin, when you mentioned that the baby might have been Sam Cooke's, Aretha Franklin's baby might have been Sam Cooke's, my original thought was, wow, that kid's got to have some amazing musical talent to be the child of Sam Cooke and Aretha Franklin. Like, what kind of magical DNA must that kid have? You know, is she a singer, or did that kid grow up to be a singer or not?
It was actually a son. Okay. I don't think he did anything. I was looking at this. What was I looking at? It was a study. The children of immigrants were hugely successful, and there was a stark difference between them and their children. The children of the children, the grandchildren of immigrants, were usually never as successful as their parents were. And I think a lot of time growing up in a certain place in life where you have lack of, the best albums came from any artist, their best album was their first, I'm sorry, their first album was the best album, because that's where a place of hunger, a right. place of, you know, those Negro spirituals, when they were singing, you could hear their pain. So, you know, these children coming from wealth and abundance tend not to be as driven as their parents were. Though I cannot doubt without an iota that child is gifted vocally, because Sam Cooke's daughter she ended up breaking up with Bobby Womack and marrying Bobby Womack's younger brother. But nonetheless, a lot of, you know, and she could sing. Bobby Womack, I'm sorry, Sam Cooke's first daughter married Bobby Womack's, broke up with Bobby Womack, married Bobby Womack's younger brother, came out with an album called Womack and Womack. That album was banging too. That little girl can sing her ass off. Now, Aretha Franklin's son, he's not as motivated. I know he can sing, but he ain't dropped no albums.
Yeah, they say money changes everything, you know, and that definitely does, I think, in the artistic sense. You can see how it affects a lot of artists' careers and their writing and all that kind of stuff. Very interesting stuff, though. So, in your view, is that gospel music that Sam Cooke and Aretha Franklin were singing, is that still with us, or is that not part of the genre called gospel music today?
Well, I don't think so. I got to be honest with you. I don't think so. Let me play a clip real quick. I know I've been changed. As soon as I play it, you're going to like, oh yeah, I know that type of song. And people don't sing like that anymore. Because, you know, I don't know. I don't know why we don't sing like that normally, but we don't. But take a listen real quick. Do you mind?
No, I don't mind.
Okay.
If we can hear it.
No, I've been changed. Come on, somebody. Angels in heaven done sign my name. Who sang like that? Are you kidding me? Who sang like that now? 91. No. Moses Staff ain't got nothing on that.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. I went to school with somebody who is celebrated within the gospel music community today, named Donnie McClurkin. You familiar with that name?
Of course.
Yeah, I went to school with Donnie, and he had a twin brother named Ronnie. I think Ronnie might have passed away years ago. But when Donnie was a kid, I mean, a kid, he had this enormous talent that was just easily apparent, even as far back as elementary school, like a really, really great talent. But I think what he's doing is still, it's still, you can still see the relationship to the gospel music of Sam Cooke's era in some way.
Yeah. Now, do they have the talent to do it? Absolutely. Is it cool anymore? Probably not.
No. Well, not to get, you know, make this a whole racial discussion, but there is that adaptation of white gospel, country-ish gospel, which I think dilutes it, waters it down, and is not, it has no relationship to the Negro Spirituals where it started at all.
I got one name for you.
Go ahead.
Adele.
Oh, yeah.
Girl, I thought that was a sister. She and I got the whole coach. Girl. Becky.
No, I get that. If you don't see her and you just heard her music, you would definitely think she was probably black, right? I get that, but I forget the name of the Gatlin Singers, I think is the name of them, and they're just a white family singing gospel music, but it doesn't have the soul, it doesn't have the real, you don't feel it like, at least I don't, like I would Aretha Franklin singing the same song. It's very different. So I think there has been that appropriation, and I think that kind of creates the genre confusion where people don't really understand what gospel music is anymore because they get, you know, the white watered down white bread version of it more than the real stuff a lot of.
Yeah, absolutely. You got away with words, I see.
You know, you have to, I always have to worry about what YouTube is listening to, too. I mean, because I've gotten strikes for language I've used on here. So I want to be really kind of respectful of that and not, you know, go too far. And but there is a that appropriation that waters down the genre and confuses people as to what real gospel and authentic gospel music was. And I think that's part of, if I'm not mistaken, that part of that curse you're talking about where secularism kind of destroyed the real good stuff.
Yeah. You know, and this is, I was listening to this conversation. I'm sorry, this song by Chris Brown. And it was, matter of fact, here, let me give you an anecdote, a personal story of mine. I was in a barbershop, obviously not getting a haircut. And just talking to my friend, he's a barber. And it was like Friday, you know, Friday night, you know how we do, just in a barbershop, chopping it up. And this girl, single mother, I don't perpetuate that, but if there ever was such a thing, this single mother comes in, she has her son, he's about 12, has a daughter, she's about 7, in a room full of men, but it's cool. We respect the black woman. So she comes in there and her daughter sit down, her son gets a haircut and the music is playing. And her and her daughter are singing, and there's an awkward moment because it's a Rihanna song. And the daughter says, I know you want to see me naked, 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 naked. And it put a weird energy into the room. And, you know, because thoughts, you know, people plant seeds all the time. The little girl didn't know what type of magic and the witchcraft and her black girl magic. She didn't know about none of that. She's just going along with the flow because she likes the music and the beat. She's not listening to the lyrics, or she knows the lyrics, but maybe she doesn't understand them. Next song that comes on is Cardi B. F him, then I get some money. The whole room is waiting for the little girl to say F him, then I get some money. After that, the next song, I'm joking at this point, you know, could have been something easily to the nature of Chris Brown, These O's Ain't Loyal. Where we're at right now is such a far cry from good music. It's a shame and an embarrassment.
Wow. Great information you brought to us today. I agree with you on that last statement. Crumb TV, how often, when do you publish? I know you did a live stream yesterday, just about 24 hours ago now. How often do you go live on Crumb TV?
Well, I have a little bit less than 100,000 of a following across several media platforms. Social media, you can't just be in one place. You got to have like 100 accounts now. It's just too much.
I know.
I post every 5 minutes somewhere.
Right. Okay.
I try to be up there every day.
Cool. Well, I wish you great success for that. And I thank you for coming here and sharing that story with us. I think it's an important story. I think, again, especially the story of Sam Cooke, I wish a lot more people would get familiar with him, because I think it was a great asset to modern music, and a lot of people fail to recognize that. So I appreciate you being here and helping us get some information on this. Wish you great success, brother. And anytime you want to come back, the door is always wide open to you.
Thank you so much for having me. Shouts out to Mind Dog TV. Everybody tap in. Peace and love. I am your humble brother, Crumb.
Thank you, brother. Bye for now. Brother Crumb, Crumb TV, check it out. Again, a lot of good insights there. And, you know, I did not know all that stuff about the Bobby Womack. I did know Bobby made his career off of Sam Cooke. And the stuff about the funeral, I kind of knew about some of that stuff. I thought he was doing it as a tribute. Maybe was kind of cutting his friend a little bit. Good program today. I hope you enjoyed it. I certainly did. Tomorrow I have Alicia Doyle with me, who's a former female championship boxer turned author. Should be an enlightening program tomorrow at 1 p.m. Till then, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming. Have a great rest of your day, and bye for now.